Okay, fine, whatever. This week's discussion. Question one. What do you think Mrs. Smith's key role in the Mr. Elliot plot might say about the rigid class distinctions of that society? So remember, Mrs. Smith used to be upper class, but then her husband died. She became poor, and she's also disabled, which makes her, I'm going to say, lower class. In any case, no longer upper class. I believe her husband was not a noble, right? He was just like a middle class guy who had a lot of money. So she left the upper class by marrying him. And now she can't even squeeze into the middle class. And yet, this lower class person played a key role in the Mr. Elliot plot, which involves Mr. Elliot, an upper class person, and Anne, an upper class person, and Captain Wentworth, because Anne is like caught between these two men. And of course, Captain Wentworth is an upper middle class person. So, people of that time often think the classes are entirely separate, should have as little to do with each other as possible. We saw 2 weeks ago that when Anne goes to visit the lower class people who live on her land or her father's land, it's called a visit of charity. And yet, the solution to Anne's upper class dilemma comes from information learned from this lower class woman, Mrs. Smith. So it seems that by arranging the plot like this, the novel seems to be saying that we can't focus too much on class differences. Like, no matter if you're upper class or lower class or middle class, we all live in one society and we all have an influence or effect on each other, even across class distinctions. And this is part of what's very exciting about Persuasion, this novel. If you remember, we also talked about how sailors are not upper class. Traditionally, they're lower class. But when a captain becomes rich, suddenly he is almost as important in social life as an upper class person. In terms of class difference, in many cases, money makes more of a difference than bloodline or like relatives. So we already see in the background that the idea of having rigid class distinctions is weakening. And here the novel seems to be telling us that this could be a good thing. Okay, question two. Why do you think judging a person based on their private correspondence is a violation of the laws of honor? So why shouldn't you read other people's mail is the question. Today we would say because of privacy, but at the time that concept had not yet fully matured. So let's see what the novel says. Page 135. So this is Mrs. Smith has just told Anne what a terrible person Mr. Elliot is. And then Mrs. Smith provides this letter from Mr. Elliot to her now dead husband that proves that Mr. Elliot is a terrible person. And she shows it to Anne. Anne's reaction. Anne could not immediately get over the shock and mortification mortification here means like social awkwardness or cringiness, like feeling uncomfortable with the situation. The shock and mortification of finding such words applied to her father. So that's her first reaction, as I'm sure most of us would have the same reaction, shock. She was obliged to recollect that her seeing the letter was a violation of the laws of honor. So this tells us she had to remember she wasn't supposed to read such a letter. And we know that Anne is such a polite, kind, basically just like the perfect woman. So she, of course, knows what is the right thing to do at all times. But here she is so shocked that she has to remember what is the right thing to do. It's not a direct, immediate instinct. And so it is a violation of the laws of honor. And she had to remember that no one ought to be judged or to be known by such testimonies, this kind of evidence, that no private correspondence could bear the eye of others. She had to remember these things before she could recover calmness enough to return the letter which she had been meditating over and say thank you. So we see here the one reason that the novel gives us is that no private correspondence, no private letters could bear the eye of others. Why not? So, if you remember the movie we saw, Love and Friendship, there is a scene where the young guy, I can never remember his name, intercepts a letter from Alicia to Lady Susan, and he reads the letter, and the letter basically reveals what a terrible person Lady Susan is. And when Alicia tells this, tells Lady Susan that this has happened, her first reaction is to blame the young man for reading her letter, because it is an extremely impolite thing to do, very unlike a gentleman. And she says, of course, we all know that that's not the point, and Lady Susan is just trying to confuse things. But the reason that she gives is, if you remember later on, she calls the young man into her room and explains to him why he was wrong to read the letter. And the reason that she gives is that a letter is meant for one person only, and so if read by another person, could easily be misconstrued or misinterpreted, misunderstood. And, you know, this is true, right? When this is similar to how the kind of person that you are in front of your parents is probably quite different from the kind of person you are in front of your friends, that kind of thing. Each of us chooses to present a different side of ourselves depending on the person and depending on the situation. So in a letter, you are presenting one side of yourself, the side of yourself that your friend knows, the side of yourself that you choose when talking with the person that you're writing the letter to. The person who reads your letter may know a different side of you. And this is not hypocrisy, like it's not, you know, saying one thing and doing another. It's just naturally how people live their lives. You know, most of the time, the different sides of ourselves that we present fit together. They're the same person. It's just like a difference in attitude or a difference in emphasis, focus. And so, you know, the someone who knows a very different side of you might misunderstand your letter. And that is true. But there's also another reason, which is that, you know, today when you chat with friends using, you know, Line or like Messenger or whatever, it's basically one long conversation, right? Not every message is a complete letter because you can read the previous messages. So you don't have to give all of the information every time you type something. And in fact, in the days before phones, or I guess before cell phones, letters were the same thing. They're just, you know, much slower. You will often see letters that say, you know, thank you for the letter of like last week. And then without summarizing the letter, without reminding the reader what that letter said, the author would just say, just, you know, reply to the letter. It's like email, but without the quoting the previous emails, and you have to wait like 3 days between emails. So in other words, the reader of the letter is already, a lot of the time, is already part of the conversation. They know what this new letter is talking about. They know what their friend said before in older letters. It's all in their head. So just like, you know, for example, if you're talking with your friends and you start joking around or like being sarcastic, or even, you know, saying something as a joke, like in Chinese, maybe 在反串. If someone only heard the middle part of that conversation, they don't know you very well, they might mistakenly think that you really believe what you're saying when in fact you don't. Something similar can happen in a letter or like a conversation across many letters. Something from the middle of the conversation can be taken out of context and misunderstood. So this law of etiquette, this law of honor, which says that you cannot, or you should not, you ought not to judge or know someone by the testimony or evidence of a letter, comes about because of this reason. What was the original question? Why do you think judge is better? Oh, yes, so that's why. You know, because letters can often be like conversations, it's kind of like eavesdropping on someone else's conversation, like sneakily listening to what other people are saying without letting them know that you are listening. So, you know, for such a social society as the Society of Jane Austen, the boundary between public and private was very clear, right? We talked about things like the drawing room, the parlor. These are all rooms in the house where guests are allowed. And then there are places where guests are never allowed, like the bedroom, for example, or the nursery for kids. So the line between private and public is very clear. A letter is just like your own little bubble of privacy within a public space. The letter is meant for the recipient, the person the letter writer is writing to, only, no one else. It's kind of like, you know, if today you get a text message and you look at your phone and someone is reading the message over your shoulder, it's the same kind of dishonorable thing to do. Okay, next question. Anne thinks of herself and Captain Wentworth that if there be constant attachment on each side, our hearts must understand each other ere long. We are not boy and girl to be captiously irritable, misled by every moment's inadvertence and wantonly playing with our own happiness. Okay, so first of all, what in the world does this mean? Let's take this slowly. Let's go to page 147. Let's see. There we go. If there be constant attachment on each side. Okay. So let's take this slowly. First of all, notice this verb, be. Today, most of us would say is, if there is constant attachment. Attachment means like having feelings for the other person, still liking or loving the other person. But why does it use be here? So here's the thing. Languages change, not just the words and pronunciation, but also the grammar changes over time as well. In English today, we don't really use what's called the subjunctive, 假设语气. When you learn what in Chinese we often call 假设语气 in English grammar, you're not really learning the subjunctive. You're learning what's called the conditional, 条件假设. The conditional is the kind of sentence that always begins with if or whether. And the rule, of course, is like, if A is X, then B will Y. Is and will, present tense and future tense. But that's not a true subjunctive. A true subjunctive doesn't have to have a condition, 条件. The idea of a subjunctive mood is basically any statement that is not, that you cannot say it is true or not true, it is actually happening or not actually happening. So for example, examples are one kind of subjunctive. The example may not actually exist in real life, but you can still use it as an example. Another kind is the hypothetical situation. So like, what if this situation happens? So we're not saying that the situation will happen or will not happen. We're talking about it as if it could happen. So a subjunctive is any sentence like this that doesn't tell you whether it actually happens or actually does not happen. It could happen. It exists in the middle. Now, in English, the subjunctive is expressed by using the infinitive of the verb 人形动词. Most of the time, the infinitive is the same as the present tense, but sometimes it is very different, such as with the be verb, right? The present tense would be is, but here it is using the infinitive, which is be. So this tells us that this sentence is subjunctive. Anne is not saying that there is constant attachment on each side. She's saying there, if this situation is true, then blah, blah, blah. Right. Also, you can tell from the word surely, which is a kind of supposition, 推定语气. So surely if there be constant attachment on each side, which means surely if we each, she's talking about herself and Captain Wentworth, if we do still love each other, both of us, each other, so on each side, right? Not just me loving you, but also you loving me. Our hearts must understand each other ear long. Ear means before. So if we still love each other, we're going to find out sooner or later. We are not boy and girl. To be captiously means like suddenly or easily. Irritable, which means annoyed, but annoyed and also a little bit angry. Misled by every moment's inadvertence. Okay, so to understand this word, okay, so inadvertence as a noun means something very different from what today we say as inadvertent adjective or inadvertently adverb. To inadvertently do something means to do something unintentionally, not on purpose. But the word inadvertence comes from the root advert or advert, which means to change direction or to turn around. So an inadvertence is something that distracts you, draws your attention, makes you like go toward it and take a longer way or longer route, something that pulls you away. So I guess we can just say like distraction. But here, of course, it's not just any distraction, it's talking about distractions of the heart. So Anne is saying, you know, we're not kids anymore, we're not young anymore, to be easily irritated, easily annoyed, easily distracted by small distractions. And wantonly, which means without good reason, simply because you want to. And wantonly playing with our own happiness. So like we're not young anymore, we're not at the age where we can play silly romantic games with each other. Okay, so that's what this means. What is the question? The question is, do you agree, why or why not? So let's take this statement into half by half. So the first half, if we still love each other, we must realize it sooner or later. Okay, yeah, I guess that makes sense. Like, you know, usually the longer you spend with someone, the more time you spend with someone, the more you get to understand them. And you understand what kind of person they are, what they think, how they feel, their habits, their values. And, you know, liking someone or loving someone, I'm pretty sure is one of those values or feelings or thoughts. So, yes, I think that if they still love each other and if they remain part of each other's lives, if they continue to meet each other in daily life and to talk with each other, then yeah, I think it makes sense that they will one day realize that the other person also still loves them. What about the second part? We are not young anymore to allow ourselves to be easily distracted by our feelings for each other, and therefore, or not maybe not just feelings for each other, but like small things that make us angry about, like things that you do, things that other people say about you, like jealousy, annoyances. We're not at that age anymore where these small things, we let these small things affect our major happiness. See, that I don't agree with. It's true they are not boy and girl anymore, but if you look at how they have been behaving to each other, like getting embarrassed every day, almost every time they meet, or like when Captain Wentworth rescues Anne from the little kid Walter pulling him off her back without saying anything. And Anne is also too embarrassed to say anything, and they just don't talk. Or when Anne is talking to Lady Russell about what happened in Lyme, and she has to mention Captain Wentworth, she's so embarrassed that she can't look Lady Russell in the eye. These kinds of things, to me, just seem, you know, very immature and easily distracted. So when Anne says we are not at that age, I think they still are, really. So if you remember, I think it was 2 weeks ago, we talked about Anne's emotional maturity when compared with Captain Benwick. And at the time it said that Anne is older in feeling. But we also talked about how someone even older than Anne in feeling is Admiral Croft and his wife. This is the thing that the Admiral and his wife can do that Anne currently cannot, which is to like look at a situation directly and just like deal with it instead of getting all embarrassed. At this point, you already know that she ends up marrying Wentworth. So we can only hope that as their marriage goes on, they also slowly develop this kind of emotional maturity. Next question. We're going pretty fast today. Do you want to ask me something before we continue? Do you have questions you want to ask me?
Teacher.
Yeah.
I want to ask a question related to the number two correction.
Okay, question number two.
Number two or number one? Let me see. Oh, number two, because I want to know why Elliot want to persuade Mr. Smith.
Ah, okay, so the letter. Let's see, 135. Dear Smith, this is from Mr. Elliot to Mr. Smith. Dear Smith, I have received yours, which means I got your last letter. Your kindness almost overpowers me, which means you were very kind. This is just being polite. I lived 329. So he is currently 23 years old. I have lived 320 years in the world. This is the actual reply. Currently, I don't need your help being in Kashgan, which means I have money now. So the help means your services means I don't need you to lend me money or to give me money. So this is the point of the letter, to tell Mr. Smith that Mr. Elliot doesn't need to borrow money from him at the moment. The rest of the letter is just chatting, socializing, conversation. And that makes this letter even worse. There is no reason that Mr. Elliot had to tell Mr. Smith what he thought of Sir Walter and the Elliot family. He just did this for no reason, like to chat for fun. It's not very important to him. He doesn't care. Right? Look at how rude this is. I have got rid of Sir Walter and Miss. Miss is, I think, Elizabeth, Miss Elliot. The baronet, who is Sir Walter, is quite fool enough. He's foolish. He is worse than last year. I wish I had any name but Elliot. I am sick of it. And he says that his name is William Walter Elliot. And he says that the Walter is an insult. So, Billy, to answer your question, I don't think he's trying to persuade Mr. Smith of anything. He's just chatting. He is putting down his real thoughts and feelings into the letter.
He want to show off something or just to chat with Mr. Smith.
I think he's just chatting. You know, we can talk about the philosophy of conversation, about how sharing your feelings is a way of building up a relationship, it's a way to make friends. But I don't think he's doing this on purpose. Maybe he is, right? Because it looks like he often needs Mr. Smith's money. So it's to Mr. Elliot's benefit to keep Mr. Smith a good friend.
Okay.
So I guess maybe that might be why he's doing this. If you have ever participated in gossip, you will know that one of the fastest ways to build a friendship is to talk something bad about someone else. Because it makes the two gossipers feel like they are on the same side. This also works in politics, too. The best way to build a political movement is to seek a common enemy. So I think maybe that's what Mr. Elliot is doing.
Okay, so yeah. It's just to keep a relationship with Smith.
Yeah, for the money.
Mm. Thank you.
All right, thanks. When talking about this idea of we should not read other people's letters, I gave the example of the movie Love and Friendship. That movie is based on a short novella called Lady Susan, but the writer of the movie also brought in story ideas from Jane Austen's other novels. And I'm guessing that scene in the movie was probably taken directly from this scene in the novel. It's the exact same logic. Even though the emphasis is on a different part, right? In the movie, the emphasis is on Lady Susan being a terrible person and using this as an excuse. Here, the emphasis is on Anne being a good person and realizing she should not have done this. But it's the same situation. Okay, other questions before we take a break? No? Okay, let's take a break. Okay, let's continue. Question 4. In the end, Anne believes that she was right to refuse Captain Wentworth the first time. Do you agree? Why or why not? Okay, let's take a look at this, page 164. Here she's talking with Captain Harville. And she says, I have been thinking over the past and trying impartially to judge of the right and wrong. I mean, with regard to myself. And I must believe that I was right, much as I suffered from it, that I was perfectly right in being guided by the friend whom you will love better than you do now. She is, of course, talking about Lady Russell. To me, she was in the place of a parent. So she was just like my mother, because, of course, Lady Elliot had died already. Do not mistake me, however. I'm not saying that she did not err in her advice. Okay, so Anne is saying that Lady Russell's advice was wrong. But she also says that she was right to listen to the advice. Huh. It was perhaps one of those cases in which advice is good or bad only as the event decides. So depending on the consequences, depending on how things turn out. So here she's saying, the advice was bad advice, but maybe it was bad advice only because of how things turned out. Maybe at the time it could have been good advice. And by how things turned out, Anne is of course talking about the fact that Wentworth later became rich. And for myself, I certainly never should, in any circumstance of tolerable similarity, give such advice. So Anne is saying, if someone in a similar situation asked me for my advice, I would not give them the same advice. I would not tell them not to get married. But I mean that I was right in submitting to her, to Lady Russell, in obeying Lady Russell. And that if I had done otherwise, I should have suffered more in continuing the engagement than I did even in giving it up, because I should have suffered in my conscience. So she's saying, I was right to obey Lady Russell, because if I had disobeyed her, then no matter what happened, I would have felt guilty in my conscience. I have now, as far as such a sentiment is allowable in human nature, nothing to reproach myself with. So, having listened to Lady Russell, I do not feel the need to blame myself. This middle part is being polite. As far as anyone can say, they don't blame themselves. Like, of course, everyone is guilty because of original sin. So you can't say you don't blame yourself. You just don't blame yourself as much. So this is being polite. And if I mistake not, a strong sense of duty is no bad part of a woman's portion. This is also being polite. So if I'm not mistaken, I do believe that duty is important for a woman. A woman's portion here means a woman's duty. So following who you should follow is important for being a woman. Now, this last sentence looks sexist. And today we would say it is sexist. But Anne is not here comparing between women and men. She is simply saying that in order to be a good woman, she should have a sense of duty. She should follow the people that she's supposed to follow. It says nothing about what it takes to be a good man. In fact, I'm pretty sure that even men should also have a strong sense of duty, should also follow their parents, that kind of thing. So it's not comparing between men and women. It's just saying because she is a woman, in order to be a good woman, she believes that she should have a sense of duty to her parents. In this case, Lady Russell. And she only says this to be polite because it's OK. Let's look deeper into her answer. So we know that she thinks she should follow. She indeed did the right thing in following Lady Russell's advice. First, because, you know, it's like her parent. It's like listening to her mother, and people should listen to their parents. So that's the second reason she gives. But what's the first reason? It is advice that is good or bad only as the event decides. In other words, at the moment that Lady Russell was giving the advice, she could not have known whether this would indeed be good or bad advice. It really depended on how Captain Wentworth did in the war, how much money he was able to make. Turns out he made a lot, but at the time that Lady Russell is giving the advice, she could not have known this. But at the same time, Lady Russell could not have said that Captain Wentworth would not become rich. It goes both ways, right? Is good or bad only as the event decides. And yet Lady Russell gives the advice not to marry. And that's why Anne says, if it were up to her, if she herself had to give us, if someone in her situation came to her for advice, she certainly would not have given that advice. Because at that moment, you can't really know whether it would be good or bad advice. So it's best just to shut up and not give advice. So, you know, if Anne could tell that Lady Russell's advice was bad, then she would have a reason not to obey Lady Russell. And the question there would become, which is more important? Her own happiness with her new husband, or continuing to be a good, kind, and obedient young woman, or young, even just young person? It would have been a real dilemma. But here, there is no good reason to disobey. There's no good reason, there's no good evidence that the advice is bad, or that the advice is good. There's no evidence about the advice. So since the advice itself could be either good or bad, we don't know, then the only pressure is to follow. There is no, incentive, yoing. There's only the incentive to follow. There is no incentive to disobey. And that's why, in conclusion, Anne thinks she did the right thing in breaking off her engagement with Captain Wentworth. And it is also why she adds this last sentence, because the first part of her logic implies that if she was sure that it was bad advice, maybe she would not have listened. So like she's afraid that Captain Harville might think that the only reason she listened to Lady Russell is because she couldn't tell whether the advice is good or not. In that case, it would not be real duty. It would not be real obedience. It would simply be, you know, oh, I might as well do what everyone says is the right thing. So this last polite sentence is to help Anne maintain her image as the obedient, loving, caring, blah, 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 perfect woman. Right, she's saying it was my duty to obey. And this is to counteract the effect of, oh, the advice is good or bad only as the event decides. So, do you agree? Yeah, I think Anne makes sense here. Okay, last question for today. Last question for the entire novel, and the last question for the scope of the final exam, and we will talk about the exam next week. Do you think everyone gets their just desserts at the end? Which means, do you think people get what they deserve? How would you describe the morality of the ending? Okay, so we're talking about whether at the end of the novel, the good people get good endings and the bad people get bad endings. In other words, we should think about whose lives have changed throughout the course of the novel. Well, obviously, the first one is Anne and Wentworth. They are the two like best people, I believe, in the novel. Well, we know Anne is the best person. Is Wentworth the best guy? He's the best single guy, let's say that. So, what do they get? They get married, and that's good. But it's not like a perfect, happy, ideal marriage, because as the ending of the novel tells us, this is the last page, page 177. She might have been absolutely rich and perfectly healthy and yet be happy. Okay, all good things. But his profession was all that could ever make her friends wish that tenderness less. The dread of a future war, all that could dim her sunshine. So it's not a perfect marriage because Captain Wentworth is still a captain. He's still a soldier. And, you know, the war that they were fighting has ended. This is the... So the novel was published in 1817. So the most recent war ended in 1815. Do you guys know which war that was? It was the war against Napoleon. So like the French Revolution happened in 1789. Then there was the Reign of Terror, 恐怖统治. And then to get rid of the people, like chopping off people's heads, the public supported Napoleon, is this genius general. And he had so much support that he was able to declare himself emperor. And then he started invading like other countries in Europe. And of course, nobody likes getting invaded. So all of Europe banded together, including England, joined together to fight Napoleon. And because England is, of course, an island, so the main way that they fought Napoleon was using the navy. So in fact, that's the war that Wentworth was fighting against France, the Napoleonic Wars. So, you know, if in the future another war breaks out and England has to use its navy again, then Wentworth has to go to war again and he might die. Remember in the first week, I think, or the second week, we talked about how the naval warfare at the time was like. And we, in our discussion, we said that a lot of it has to do with luck. And Captain Wentworth was very lucky. He may not be lucky in the next war. So this is something that Anne is constantly anxious about. So even though they are our two best characters, best people in the novel, they don't really get the perfect ending. Of all the endings, I think this is the best one, but it's not perfect. Okay, so who else's lives have changed? Mr. Elliot. Oh, yes, big change. He is revealed as an evil person, and as soon as he hears that Anne is engaged to Captain Wentworth, he runs off to London. Let's take a look at this. Let's see if I can find it. There we go. This is page 176. It was just a previous page. Okay. Is this the original ending? Oh, it is the original ending. Jeez. I totally forgot that I included the original ending. Oops. Huh. Let's see if I can find this. Yeah, no, it's the same. This part of the ending is the same in the final ending and in the original ending. Were you guys confused to have to read another two extra chapters? I'm so sorry about that. I forgot that I included that. So this is page 166. What we just talked about, Anne having to worry about Captain Wentworth being a sailor also happens in the final ending. So that's fine. But here, 166. The news of his cousin Anne's engagement burst on Mr. Elliot most unexpectedly. He could still, so even though he was discomfited and disappointed, he could still do something for his own interest and his own enjoyment. He soon quitted Bath, which means he left Bath. And on Mrs. Clay's quitting it likewise soon afterwards and being next heard of as established under his protection in London. Okay. So Mrs. Clay ends up with Mr. Elliot. Very interesting. But they don't end up being married yet. Because it says that she is under his protection, which kind of means like he is kind of like her master. Like she may be like a housekeeper. She may be living in his house as a friend. But really, she's just dependent on him, right? It's his protection. He is protecting her. So the two evil people in the story, Mr. Elliot and Mrs. Clay, don't get what they want. And it does seem like Mrs. Clay really did want to marry Sir Walter. But here, the novel says basically that Mrs. Clay has now turned her sights on to Mr. Elliot. And since she has failed to seduce Sir Walter, she may now try to seduce Mr. Elliot. Because remember, Mr. Elliot is the heir presumptive of the baronetcy. When Sir Walter dies, Mr. Elliot will become Sir William, an inherent Kellynch. So these two evil people end up together. And if they do get married, it's not because they love each other. So, I mean, yeah, it's not a very good ending, right? But it's also not like a very bad ending. The worst that we can say about this ending is that in terms of the social world of the novel, these two people have been cast out of their original social circle. And since society is so important in the novel, to them, this is a big punishment. But to us today, it doesn't feel like a big punishment, right? It just feels like, oh, so they have to make new friends. They have to start over. So I think it would feel worse to the original readers of the novel. Yeah, in the actual ending, this sentence still appears, right? The dread of a future war, all that could dim her sunshine. Okay, who else has had their lives changed? Louisa and Captain Benwick, right? Louisa had the accident. Last week we talked about how her entire personality changed. Her interests change, and of course she marries Benwick. That seems like a pretty happy ending, right? And they both deserve a happy ending. They both have suffered a lot in the novel. Benwick, his fiance, had recently died, and he's very heartbroken. Louisa had an accident and is also pretty heartbroken, I assume, because Captain Wentworth is not going to marry her. The novel does say that they appear like they will be happy in their new marriage. So that's very good for them. That's good. That's nice. Who else has had their lives changed? Sir Walter and Elizabeth have become slightly more important for knowing Lady Dalrymple and Miss Carteret. That's not a real change. I guess like it's a slight improvement. But if you think about how much they care about these social connections, if you take that as a bad thing, as something that feeds their vanity and their pride, then this ending is actually a bad ending because it makes them even more selfish and vain and proud. It is exactly as they were, but more so. Let's see, does anyone else change by the end of the novel? I think that's it, right? Okay, so the question is, how would you describe the morality of this ending? So like the best people get the best ending, but it's not perfect. The worst people get the worst ending, but it's not the end of the world. And the people who have suffered a lot also get a happy ending. So I would say that this kind of morality is like a very forgiving Christian morality. Like it doesn't, it's not strictly, you know, black and white. Good people get all the good things, bad people get all the bad things. There's some flexibility, there's some space. It's not very extreme. And this is also a kind of kindness. So we can say that the novel is trying to show us the value of being kind to other people, not just by giving us the main character of Anne, who is so kind and so perfect, but also in the way that it ends, in the different endings that it gives to different people. The endings themselves also feel kind. Okay, those are the five questions. Do you want to ask me something, my dear students? Questions?
Teacher?
Yes.
I have one more correction on page 154.
154, yes.
Yes, I want to know the Captain Harville, because they put a conversation between Harville and Anne.
Right.
So I want to know why the purpose of the conversation.
Okay, so from the character's perspective, they're just chatting at a party. And I think Captain Harville is the person who brings up this topic. And he wants to talk about this because he's thinking about how Captain Benwick, like seemingly just weeks ago, was still heartbroken over having lost his fiancée Fanny. But now it seems, you know, pretty happy to be marrying Louisa. It's a sudden change. And because Fanny is Harville's sister, he cares about whether this means that Benwick was not, in fact, a very loving fiancé in the first place. Like, if he could love someone else so quickly, does that mean he was not really a good person? Did Fanny choose the wrong guy? So that's why Harville wants to bring this up with Anne. And of course, he brings this up with Anne because everybody knows Anne is the wisest and is the kindest and like has a good head on her shoulders. So if they want advice, the best advice would be to listen to what Anne has to say. So that's from Harville's point of view. From Anne's point of view, she at first is just answering his question. But when the discussion grows general, So not just about Benwick, but about men and women. Then Anne feels invested in the conversation, because if they reach a conclusion about men and women and like how constant is their love, like how persistent, how long does their love last, then this says something about her as well, right? If they conclude that women love, that men love longer than women, that says something bad about women. But if they conclude that women love longer than men, that says something bad about Benwick. So that's why they are able to have a conversation, because both sides are important. And if I remember correctly, the conversation ends with Anne again giving way and replying something like, maybe you're right, without actually saying you're right, or something like that. I can't quite remember. No, no, no. We shall never agree upon this question. So this is page 155. So the conversation ends with disagreement. Harville still says that men love longer. Anne still says that women love longer. So that's from the two characters' perspective. But why is this conversation in the novel? It is in the novel to solve a very specific problem. And that problem is that Anne knows she still loves Wentworth, and Wentworth knows that he still loves Anne. And Anne has already guessed that Wentworth still loves her. But Wentworth does not know that Anne still loves him. So how do we let Wentworth know this? You can't simply have Anne tell him, because they can only meet in public. They don't have a reason to meet in private where they could have a private conversation. You know, Anne, we've talked twice before about how whenever Anne does something, she always has to have a good social reason. She can't just do whatever she wants. So the novel has to solve this problem. How do they have a private conversation in public? And the solution that Jane Austen settled on is to have Wentworth overhear Anne talk about how Anne believes that women love longer than men. And if that is true, if women do love longer than men, and Wentworth still loves Anne, then logic would tell us that Anne also still loves Wentworth. And that's how Wentworth discovers that Anne still loves him. And so the problem then becomes, how does Wentworth let Anne know that he knows that she still loves him? Sorry, it's a bit confusing, but it's a very like intricate social problem. And the way that the novel solves this second problem is to have Wentworth, when he's supposed to be writing one letter, secretly write another letter to Anne, and then just as he's going to leave, he finds an excuse to come back and stuff the secret letter into Anne's hands. And the letter tells Anne, basically, oh, I just heard your conversation and I finally realized you still love me. We should get married, something like that. So the reason that the novel has this conversation in the first place is to solve that problem. Now, if you took the time to read the original ending to the novel, you will realize this is not Jane Austen's first solution. Her first solution was to create some sort of excuse to put Wentworth and Anne in the same room with nobody else. Now, basically everybody agrees that the new ending is better. First of all, it's more exciting, as I'm sure you will agree. Secondly, the original excuse that Austen used to get Anne and Wentworth in the same room is to have Admiral Croft call Wentworth in. Sorry, to call Anne in. And then basically say, haha, joke's on you. I don't have a reason to call you. So it doesn't make sense. There's no reason that Admiral Croft would do this. So this is also the more convincing ending. Does that answer your question?
Oh, yes. Okay.
Great.
Because I think the conversation may be related to the letter from Wentworth.
Right. Wentworth has to write the secret letter to Anne in order to let Anne know that he knows that she still loves him. Right, it's a communication issue.
Yes.
And he only learns that she still loves him by overhearing her conversation. So it is related.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. Do we have other questions? No? Okay. Okay, World War One. The thing you have to know about World War One is that it is a completely new kind of war, a completely new logic of fighting wars. So traditionally, when people go to war and they fight on the battlefield, it's more like a contest of strength, or like a competition of strength, right? You fight with actual weapons that you have to use with your hands to hit the enemy with, like a sword or an axe, or maybe you have a shield. And so many times, or most times, the stronger fighter will win the fight. And this also applies to whole armies, right? If you fight wars depending on individual strength, then the more soldiers you have, the stronger your army is. Most of this is no longer true for the First World War. And the main reason is because of the invention of things like artillery, pao, and the machine gun, ji guan qiang. So when guns were first used in war, they looked very different from machine guns. For example, in the American Revolution, the main kind of gun is called the musket, mao se qiang. Here's how you use a musket. It's a long gun. It looks like a rifle. You take a musket. First, you have to, before entering battle, you would prepare pouches of gunpowder. And to load the musket, you take the one pouch of gunpowder and you pour it into the barrel of the gun, through the front of the gun, down the tube, which is called a barrel. After you pour in the gunpowder, then you take the bullet or the shot, which is basically just an iron ball, and you also put it into the front of the barrel of the gun. And then you take an iron rod or stick, and again, from the front of the gun, you push everything down into the back of the gun. And then after you take out the iron rod, you pull back the hammer so that when you pull the trigger, it will hit the flint, and the flint will create a spark, and the spark will light the gunpowder, and the gunpowder will explode, and it will push out the shot. You have to do this for every single shot. So, you know, first of all, it's slow and impractical. But secondly, the bullet or the shot does not travel very far. If you have ever seen a movie about the American Revolution, or, you know, like 19th century war, or even 18th century war, you will notice that when the soldiers carrying muskets shoot at each other, they don't just shoot. They have to, each side forms a line of soldiers aiming their guns at the enemy, and they march in formation as a line toward the enemy, all while aiming their gun, and all while the enemy is aiming their gun at us. And the reason they have to do that is because the muskets, the range of the muskets is very short. So you have to make sure that you are close enough to the enemy in order for your musket to actually do any harm or any damage. So the main question in this kind of early gun-based battle is, on the one hand, you have to get close enough to your enemy, but on the other hand, you can't wait too long or your enemy will fire first. But if you fire first and you're not close enough, then you've wasted one very valuable shot and you have to spend 2 minutes preparing the next shot. So you can't stop the enemy's attack. So that's how you had to use muskets at the beginning of gun warfare. Basically, what ended up happening is, after you get too close to the enemy and after you fire your own shot, your commander will order you to attach bayonets, 枪刺, a knife at the front of the gun. And so it would just basically turn into more traditional sword or knife-based warfare, except now your sword is a gun with a knife in front. So it's still a very traditional kind of fighting based on individual strength. But before World War I, we had another very important invention, and this is rifling. So why is a long gun in English called a rifle? Because the barrel of the gun has rifling. And what this means is that the barrel is not just an iron tube. Inside the iron tube are carved a spiral shape. More than one spiral. I think it's two or three spirals. Like, do you remember the opening of every 007 movie? Where they show like a circle representing a gun, and then like the camera, 007 shoots at the camera. If you remember that circle, it's not all black outside of the circle. There are lines, right? There's a spiral line. Let's see if I can find this actually. Yeah, see? You see these spiral lines? This is called rifling, and they exist in order to make the bullet spin. And when a bullet spins, it can cut through the air. And when it cuts through the air, it can travel farther, and therefore faster, and therefore with more power. So you no longer have to, you know, line up and get close to your enemy. As long as you have good aim, you can hit the enemy from a good distance. That's the first important change between traditional gun warfare and the First World War. The second big change is the invention of automatic gunfire. So as we just discussed, every time you load a musket, not only do you have to add the gunpowder and the shot, you also have to pull back the hammer that hits the gunpowder, or that hits the flint, which is like a piece of rock, or in this case, iron. And when it hits the flint, it creates a spark. Anyway, later on, someone invented the bullet, which adds the gunpowder to the thing that is shooting out of the gun. So you don't have to add the gunpowder separately. It's part of the bullet. And so now the hammer doesn't hit a flint that creates a spark that lights the gunpowder. The hammer hits the back of the bullet. And the back of the bullet, when you hit the back of the bullet, it will compress the gunpowder. And it will add pressure to the gunpowder that will make the gunpowder explode and push the bullet out. So the mechanism is simpler, It's more protected from things like rain. And because the hammer is hitting an explosion, you can also use that explosion to push the hammer back and to cock it and prepare it for the next bullet. And that's automatic gunfire. So now when you pull the trigger, the hammer, and you release the trigger, the hammer jumps back and you can just keep on pulling the trigger. Sorry, you don't have to let go of the trigger because every bullet that the hammer hits, it will bounce back and prepare to hit the next bullet. What this means is that in order to kill many enemy soldiers, all you have to do is aim and keep your finger on the trigger and not let go. So one machine gun can basically kill every single soldier that the machine gun can see. So now when you fight a war with machine guns, the number of soldiers that you have does not really matter until you have a massive number of soldiers, so many soldiers that a machine gun cannot take out all of them. But the generals in World War I didn't really understand that the strategy had changed. It had been a number of years since the previous war. They had not had time to understand the changes in military technology. So that's why you have things like when the war began, the British soldiers still wore their traditional uniform of bright red. And today you think, what in the world? Why would they wear something that's so easy to see? And the answer is because back in the days of muskets, it was more important to see where your fellow soldiers are, because as long as they're not too close to the enemy, the gun can't hit them, so it's fine. And also, like, the bright red is supposed to be scary to the enemy because the British were such a powerful army. So it's also like psychological warfare. But now that we have machine guns and rifling, as soon as you see a bright red uniform, that British soldier is basically dead. So the British Army had to learn to change their uniform to something that is harder to see. Like today, that's why most soldiers wear green or like light blue or like light brown, that, these kinds of colors that are hard to see. The other main strategy that was no longer effective is trench warfare, 壕沟战争. So trench warfare basically means you dig a long hole in the ground where you hide your soldiers until you can get enough reinforcements, enough soldiers to overrun the enemy. So it's basically waiting for enough soldiers. It's a numbers game. But as we just said, once you have a machine gun, the numbers don't matter much anymore until you have a lot more soldiers than the other side. So that's why we kept having stalemates, 僵持, 僵局, during World War I, because each time one side would try to attack, the other side would just mow down everybody using their machine gun. And then after defending the attack, the machine gun side would then start their own attack, and the first side would mow them down using machine guns, and nobody got anywhere. There were no advances at all. People just died. Millions of people died for no reason. Well, for the reason that the strategies were bad. And this completely is different from what most people thought about war. Most people were still believing that war is glorious and honorable because it's a contest of strength. First, because the technology is too new, but also because most people in school still had to learn about I should say most people who go to school and most people who listen to classic stories still learned about war through the Homeric epics, the Iliad, the Odyssey. And the thing to remember about the Iliad and the Odyssey is that the Trojan War is told entirely, 100%, through the eyes of heroes, not common soldiers, but like kings and generals. So of course they will care about honor and glory. Of course they will be stronger and faster than the common soldier. So that's still what most people thought about war. Glorious, honorable, contest of strength. And it's also important to remember at the time that it was considered morally good and morally just and necessary to support your own country during a war, no matter whether the reason for that war is good or not. And this is mainly because journalism, today we have the press that is supposed to be neutral and objective. That is a very recent invention. In the 19th century and before, newspapers were openly and completely biased. In fact, the origin of newspapers is to give a place for people to share their opinions and try to persuade other people of what's going on, and also as a place to report on things that look bad for the government, to let people know what the government doesn't want you to know. So from the beginning, the news is biased, has been biased. And that was called yellow journalism because it was written on cheap yellow paper. This was so bad that in an early U.S. election between Vice President John Adams and Thomas Jefferson, John Adams's people in the newspapers wrote that Thomas Jefferson was a French spy. Thomas Jefferson's people in the newspapers wrote that John Adams was dead. He was no longer alive. Neither of these things was true, of course, but that's how biased the news could be. For example, the Spanish-American War in the middle of the 19th century started because newspapers told like big lies about what Spain was doing. So at the time of the First World War, all of the newspapers, all of the media were saying this is a just war, it is important for England to defeat the evil Germans or whatever. So simply saying that you are against the war, or even that you are against the idea of any war, is seen as unpatriotic, immoral, cowardly, afraid, not good things. So the expectation is, if you can, you will join the war. And in reality, what this means is that millions of young men were being sent to die for no good reason. By the way, the reason that Germany lost the First World War is because they did not have enough young men to keep sending into the war. And that's what led England and France and the Allies to have a big enough number of soldiers to finally defeat the Germans. They killed all the German young men. That's how they won the First World War. So that's the background of the war. Siegfried Sassoon is an upper class gentleman, young man, who joined the war for these traditional reasons, but he very quickly realized that the First World War is completely different from what everyone expected, and that people were dying for no good reason. He tried to tell the army what was going on, but the army, and he tried to like write in a newspaper to tell people what was going on, but the army simply replied to say that he had shell shock, which today is called PTSD, 创伤后症候群. And the idea was because artillery, pao, was so new, the idea of having explosions going on all the time is so new that it was damaging people's minds. And it's true, that happened. That's why it's called shell shock. Shell is the name for a bomb fired from an artillery cannon. 就是炮弹, shell. But here's the thing. Even if someone has shell shock, that does not change the fact that his fellow soldiers are dying for no reason in large numbers. That has nothing to do with shell shock. So you can see that the army is just basically lying about Siegfried Sassoon in order to keep fighting the war. And most people believed it, even though it made no sense. First of all, because shell shock is a new thing. People didn't really understand what it was. And secondly, because, as I just said, most people wanted to fight the war. They thought it was good to fight the war. So the only thing that Sassoon could think of, or the best way that he had to try to change people's minds, is to go directly to the people by giving readers the experience of being a soldier in World War I. To do that, he wrote poetry. This is before the days of the internet. This is before TV. This is before the radio. Poetry was basically the public literature, the public entertainment. And so he wrote literature that is ironic and biting and like accusing and bitter and also heartbreaking and powerful. So we're going to read three of those poems. By the way, irony does not mean sarcasm, right? Irony, ironic in Chinese, we usually translate this as 讽刺. But what it really means in English is that things are not what they look like. You think it's like one thing, but it's actually like something else. So the irony in Sassoon's poetry is the difference between what people think World War I is like and what the war is actually like. That's the irony. After the war, Sassoon got wounded once. He went back, he got wounded again and was let out of the army. So he survived. Later on, he became more religious. He wrote religious poetry. Also, he was gay, and he was never really happy with himself because of his war experience and because he was gay. The other poet, Wilfred Owen, was not upper class, but he still joined the war for the same reasons. He got wounded once, and in the hospital, he met Siegfried Sassoon, and that's how Owen started writing poetry. His poetry is also ironic, but it's not as bitter, it's not as biting. It's more full of like sorrow and pity at the waste of human life. It feels sadder. And the thing to know about Owen is that after he was wounded, he recovered and went back to join the war again. And he died 1 month before the war ended. And that fact of his life really gives his poems a big sense of tragedy. And so we're going to read two of his poems. Also ironic, but less accusing and just more pity and sadness. Okay, so that's the introduction to next week. Do you have questions? Do you want to ask me something? No? Okay, so remember next week after we talk about the poems, I will also show you the final exam questions. Okay, that's it today. Have fun reading the poems and stay safe.